Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Dan Roth.
I'm going to get down on my knees. Let's go before the Lord together in prayer today. Father, we're grateful today that we can boldly approach the throne of grace and obtain mercy and grace to help in a time of need. And Lord, we do want to lift up our senior pastor, Pastor Jim Cobray, to you as he goes in for back surgery tomorrow. God, we would ask, according to your word, God, that you would send forth your word and that you would heal him, God. Touch his body physically, Lord. We know that already it's been paid for at the cross. It's already done in the supernatural realms, God. And so now we believe you to bring it into the natural realm, that by your stripes he was healed. God, as he goes through this procedure tomorrow morning, we pray, Father God, that you just guide the doctor's hands. May it be a quick surgery. May there be no complications, God. We ask, Lord, for a speedy recovery in the name of Jesus, and that he would be pain-free for the rest of his days here on the earth, and he would be able to enjoy his time off, that he would be able to just be blessed in his times with you, God, that you blessed him and Pastor Deborah, God, during this sabbatical time, Lord, of rest, God, and refreshment, Lord, and encouragement, God. Thank you for just instilling strength and goodness into their lives, their marriage, God, all their dreams and vision, their future and their destiny, God. We thank you, Lord, that you have your hand upon them. In Jesus' mighty name. Lord, also, as we approach your word today, God, when we open it up, we pray that you open us up to receive it. God, we'll do our part, and we know that you'll do your part, God. So we give our interest, our attention, God. We look into the things of God to get understanding, God, and to grow in the wisdom and the knowledge of God. So that doesn't happen because we heard from a man or a woman, from the young or the old, the black, the white, or the brown, God. That happens because your Holy Spirit is the teacher. Come, Holy Spirit, we welcome you in this place. Be our teacher, be our guide. Give us the vision, the wisdom, the direction, the instruction, even the correction that we need for our everyday lives, Lord. We give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it. God, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves. Also, we'd ask it for all the churches, both here in the Inland Empire, as well as around the planet, that are preaching and hearing the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. They're our brothers and sisters, Lord. At no time do we think of ourselves as any better than anybody else. But we see ourselves as co-workers and laborers in your field, building your kingdom. So God, we would ask that you bless the Baptists, Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalians, Charismatics, Pentecostals. God, we thank you for Calvary Chapel, Harvest, Oak Valley, for the Well on the Way, for Ecclesia, for Trinity and Emmanuel Baptist, God, all the great churches that are out there, too many to name, God. We bless the Four Square denomination, God, and the Assemblies, Lord, Victory, the Adventist brothers and sisters that are out there, Lord, and our Catholic brothers and sisters. Lord, we bless them. They're preaching your gospel and your truth as you would bless us this day. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement. We say,
amen.
Amen. Today, get your Bible out as you're having a seat. Go with me once again to the wonderful text of Hebrews. Last week when we were together, we launched into, after 3 years of being in the book of Hebrews, going line upon line, precept upon precept, Hebrews the 11th chapter, verse number 1. Started a series last week called Defining Faith. And as we approached the Word of God, we found out some things about how not only we define faith, but how faith defines us. If you remember, Hebrews the 11th chapter, verse number 1 says this. It says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Let me just refresh your memory from last week. Don't worry if you weren't here last week. You'll be able to get on board right where we're at, and today's message really stands on its own. But last time we were together, we found out that in part number one, faith is the substance of things hoped for, that we can build our lives on the foundation of faith. Secondly, we learned that faith is the evidence of things not seen. It is a evidence. It's something that will stand up in court, that if we were to go to court based on our faith, that we could argue it in court, it would stand in the high court of heaven. And therefore, we learn that because of that, we can live by faith. Very important that if we're going to live a life, we're going to live it by faith. Faith in Almighty God, faith in His Word, faith for great and mighty, wonderful things here on the earth. So faith is that conviction. It's that persuasion. We can't be talked out of it. We can't be argued out of it. We're not going to back down. We're not going to back off of it. It's something that we reach forward to lay hold upon, and it's that title deed that we grab a hold of that says that we have what we're believing God for. So now that we know what faith is, today, part number two, I want to find out in defining faith how faith comes. If we're going to live a life of faith, we got to understand, how do I get faith? How do I obtain it? How do I grow in my faith? How do I build faith in my life? Glad you asked the question. It's a very simple answer in the book of Romans. Turn there with me to the book of Romans, the 10th chapter. Very simple answer, very easy answer for all of us. In Romans, the 10th chapter, we're going to take a look at one verse, verse number 17, and answer the question, how does faith come? Romans chapter 10, verse number 17, says these words. It says, so then faith comes by hearing. Everybody say hearing.
Hearing.
Well, that's about a quarter of you. Everybody else, come on, get on board now. You didn't come to church to spectate. You came to participate. You are the church. So everybody say hearing.
Hearing.
There you are. And hearing by the word of God. Everybody say by the word of God. See, we hear a lot of voices each and every day. A lot of things going on, a lot of things happening. There's a lot of voices speaking into our lives. All of our lives we've had our family, our relatives, our friends, our neighbors. We've had the education system speaking into our lives, politics speaking into our lives. The media has been speaking into our lives. And they have loud voices that will try and drown out the one voice that we need to get a hold of. Because see, we could say that we have faith for things. We could say that we have faith for a better life. For life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. We can say that we have faith for all sorts of things that we can see out there in the world, but faith doesn't come based on just what is heard. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. That means that if I can find it here in the Word of God, then I can believe God for it. But if I can't find it in the Word of God, then what am I doing? That's not faith. That's not something that I can believe God for. Like, for instance, I could say I'm believing God that a purple polka-dotted elephant will walk into the room in a moment. Well, you can't find that in the Word of God. That's simply foolishness. And we're back to what we talked about last week. That's presumption. It may look like faith. It may smell like faith, but that's not faith. You will not get anything from God. Why? Because that's not the will of God. You got to find it in the Word of God. 1 John 5th chapter, he talks about how if we're going to pray and ask God for anything, that if we ask according to his will, then we know that we have the things that we've asked of him because we know that we've asked according to his will. And Jesus reiterated that in Mark the 11th chapter, where he said that when you stand praying, believe that you receive those things that you have asked of God and you will have them. So if we're going to have faith, if we're going to build faith, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. So the word of God is the will and the counsel of God for our lives. And if you can find it here in God's word, then you can believe God for it and you can receive it in your life. Are you listening today? Now, God wanted to give us a little show and tell. He wanted us to understand how this process works because it's very important for us, if we're going to live by faith, that we understand how to receive faith for the promises of God in our life. So God gave us a very simple example in our salvation. Did you know when you got saved that there was a process that went on? And that process that you went through in order to get saved, in order to believe God for your salvation, is the same process that God outlines for us in his word for every promise of God, everything we're going to believe God for, everything we can have faith for in our lives. God says, I want to make it so simple and so easy. See, because God is not this. Sometimes people view God like this. They think God is up in the heavens. And God has all sorts of blessings and goodness that he has. But he's holding on to it. And he's stingy with it. And some people get it and some people don't. But that, like, God is up there going, I want you to be blessed, but you know what? You're so stupid. You don't know how to do it. And he's just up there laughing at us. See, that's not God. God is not some sadistic, maniacal egotist up in the heavens that doesn't want us to be blessed. No, God wants to bless your life. God wants to get his word into our hearts so that we can live and walk according to what God says and have the results that God wants for our lives. So God says, I'm going to tell you not only what to do, but also I'm going to share with you how to do it, and then I'm going to give you the power of the Holy Spirit so that you can accomplish it. That's how good our God is. So God makes it so simple. He makes it so easy, and he gives us a process in our salvation. You guys want to know what it is?
Yes.
Okay, just making sure, because the front row said yes, but the rest of you guys were kind of staring at me. So you guys want to know what it is?
Yes.
You're there in Romans 10. Right? Back up with me to verse number 14 and verse number 15. The process is written out for us plainly right there. Romans, the 10th chapter, verse number 14, says this, how then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? Everybody say believed.
Believe.
See, that's faith, right? And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? Everybody say heard.
Heard.
Remember, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. And how shall they hear without a preacher? Everybody say preacher.
Preacher.
Verse number 15, and how shall they preach unless they are sent? Everybody say sent. As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the gospel of peace, who bring glad tidings of good things. Right there is the process. Did you see it? It's all written out. I had you speak it, but actually the process as you spoke it was backwards. So if we go backwards through what you spoke, we will literally see the process that we can receive faith in our lives, not only for salvation, but for every area of your life. Let me put it up on the overheads for you. Take a look at it with me up on the overheads. Sent, preach, hear, believe, call. That's the process. Plain and simple, if you're going to receive faith, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So God sends his word, right? God has given us his word. God has given us the word of God. And there are preachers and teachers who are proclaiming and declaring the word of God. Maybe it's a family member that taught you about Jesus. Maybe you came to church and you heard about him. Maybe it was you were reading a book or listening to the radio or watching television and the preacher came on. See, God sends his word in our lives. And there's a preacher that preaches the word of God. Sometimes that preacher is the Holy Spirit as you start to open up the scriptures or read a book about God or read a gospel tract or something like that. And we hear the word of God. Now, this is not a natural hearing, no more than it's a natural sight. We walk by faith and not by sight. In the same way, Galatians, the third chapter, calls it the hearing of faith. So God sends his word. There's a preacher. We hear it. And look at this. We believe it. We have that aha moment and we say, ah, I get it. I see it. God doesn't want me to die and go to hell. God wants me to be with him forever, and I want to be with him. I want to give my heart and life. And so what do? We call on the name of the Lord. And the Bible says everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. So therefore, okay, that's the process. So wait a second. I've got something else I need to believe God for in my life. Maybe you're believing God for your marriage. Well, God sends his word. There are scriptures on marriage all throughout the Bible. But you got to have a preacher. Someone's got to speak to you about it. Maybe as you open up your word, it's the Holy Spirit. Maybe you talk to someone else and they say, hey, haven't you read in Ephesians, the fifth chapter, where it talks about marriage? Haven't you read in Colossians? Haven't you read about Adam and Eve and God's original intent for marriage? And so you start to hear. As you hear, what happens? Faith rises on the inside of you. That's how it is. That's how it's supposed to be. I can actually have a good marriage. I can succeed in this thing. I don't have to be mad all the time, frustrated, sleeping on the couch. Hallelujah. You believe God, and now what do? You call on the name of the Lord. God, according to your word, I believe that I can have a good marriage. That's the process. Works in every area of your life, your finances. See, if you know what the word of God has to say about your money, about your stewardship, how you use what God has given you, then you will hear it, you will believe it, and you'll call out on God. God, I want to do well with my finances. Your healing, same thing. Someone will preach to you. Maybe you never knew that God wants you to be physically well in your physical body, doesn't want you sick. So you hear the word of God that you can be healed. You believe it and you call on God according to your word, God. Isaiah chapter 53, God, that by your stripes I was healed. Jesus went about doing good and healing all who oppressed the devil. And you call on God. That's that title deed. That's writing your name on the bottom of the page. And now you receive the promises of God in your life. See, that's how it works. But there's a problem. See, John Calvin said, faith consists not in ignorance, but in knowledge. And that not only of God, but also of the divine will. See, without the will of God, we're back to presumption. Oh, I think that God wants this, or maybe God wants this. I don't know if God wants this. No, you've got to know beyond a shadow of a doubt. And your faith stops where your knowledge stops. Did you hear that? Your faith will stop where your knowledge stops. If you don't know that God wants your children raised up in the ways of the Lord, then you will just let them do whatever they want. You'll never discipline them, and then you'll wonder why they're running amok. Wonder why they go south. Wonder what happened to them when they turned teenagers. See, that's not the will of God for your family. I can prove it to you from the word front to back, cover to cover. It's all throughout the word of God about your children. You can find things that say, train up a child in the way of the Lord, and they shall not depart from them even when they grow old. See, I can't believe that promise if I never heard it. I cannot have faith for my children if I never heard the promises of God for my family. See, my faith will stop where my knowledge stops. What's the word of God say? My people die for lack of what? Knowledge. So what you don't know actually can hurt you. I'm reminded of a story about a lady, a very wealthy lady, who's going to have a party. And so she decided that she didn't want to just have, you know, one of those run-of-the-mill elegant parties. Everybody comes over and looks at your stuff and, you know, everybody thinks you're so cool. That's boring. That's just the surface level. She really wanted to wow her guests. She lived by a forest, and so she decided she was going to go out in the forest, and she had seen some wild mushrooms growing on a walk one day, and she thought, maybe if I pick these wild mushrooms and serve them up as stuffed mushrooms, that would be a great, you know, thing that, like, I went and picked these myself, and here they are, and that sort of thing, really wow her guest with this food. And so the problem was, though, that she didn't know whether or not the mushrooms were good to eat. So she went and picked them. She brought them back. She got her personal chef together there in the kitchen. She said, "Now, chef, I don't know if these mushrooms are good to eat or not." And he said, "Well, I don't know either. I just cook the food. I don't make those kinds of decisions." So they decided what they would do is they would feed some of the mushrooms to the dog, cut it up in the dog food, and then check the dog out and see if the dog got sick or if the dog was fine. And that was kind of their little test. And so they cut them up and they put it in the dog food. The dog wolfs it down, and the dog's just fine. They're watching the dog, and they're saying, "Well, it doesn't look like anything's happening." You know, a couple hours go by, dog's still good. So she says, "All right, chef, I'm going to go up and get ready. I want you to prepare the meal. I want you to prepare the stuffed mushrooms. And I want you to watch the dog and just make sure, because, you know, maybe a couple hours isn't enough. Let's keep watching them and see what happens." And so she goes up to get dressed. The chef prepares the meal, prepares the stuffed mushrooms. Everything's looking good, and dog's just fine. Guests start to arrive. They're coming in. She says, "Go ahead and serve them up. It looks like we're okay." So they serve them up. She's got her servers going out there with these stuffed wild mushrooms that she picked from the forest. Everybody is just wowed by it. It's like the icing on the cake for the party. She is just like, you know, in heaven, when suddenly the chef comes out of the kitchen with a very concerned look on his face. And he walks up behind her and he says, "Ma'am, the dog is dead." So she says, "You get back in the kitchen. Everybody, attention. I am so embarrassed. I am so sorry. We all need to go to the hospital right now." So they all head out. They all get in their cars. They all head to the hospital. Everybody gets their stomachs pumped, and they are just, you know, aghast and just like, "Oh, my goodness, how could this happen?" And so she comes back humiliated. It was the worst party she's ever had. She couldn't believe the embarrassment. And so she goes back home. And as she comes home, she comes in and she goes into the kitchen. And there's the chef sitting at the table, a sad look on his face. And she sits down across the table from him, doesn't say anything. Finally, after a moment of silence, he looks up and he says, "Man, that car really did mess up the dog when it hit it." See, what you don't know actually can't hurt you. And it's no different with the Word of God. If you don't know that you can have victory over the devil's going to beat you up each and every day. If you don't know that you can break free from addictions and bondages, if you didn't know the promises of God about your deliverance, you will stay bound and stay shackled to that old man and to that old sin. But you don't have to stay that way. The promises of God for you are yes and amen, but your faith stops where your knowledge stops. Let me show it to you in the book of Acts. Turn there with me to Acts chapter number 19. Acts chapter number 19, we see this principle in the Word of God. The Apostle Paul is traveling. He goes through Corinth. Now he's coming through the regions of Ephesus. And the Bible says he finds some disciples, okay? These disciples are disciplined followers. They're following something. They're believers in something, okay? And so he starts to talk to them. And as he's talking to them, he realizes these guys are lacking something. They don't look like the rest of the Christians and the rest of the disciples that I encounter. And look at Acts chapter number 19, verse number 2. Look at what the Apostle Paul says, finding some disciples. Verse 2, he said to them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?" So he looked at their life and he said, I see that these guys, you know, are disciples, but they're lacking the power of the Holy Spirit in their lives. So he asked them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?" So they said to him, "We have not so much as heard that there even is a Holy Spirit," or whether there is a Holy Spirit. So their knowledge stopped, therefore their faith had stopped. And so he goes on, he preaches the gospel to them, they hear the Word of God, and now look at the results. Drop down to verse number 5 and verse number 6. It says, "When they heard this," heard the gospel, "they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus." See, before it was just John's baptism, just the flesh, just repentance from dead works. But now they're baptized into the name of the Lord Jesus because they had heard the gospel, they believed, now they call on the name of the Lord, now they're baptized. Look at the next verse number 6. "And when Paul laid hands on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they spoke with tongues and prophesied." So now they heard about the Holy Spirit, they heard about the power of God, and now they call on the name of the Lord, they lay hands on them, right? And they receive the gift. Why? Because we know that because they spoke in tongues and they prophesied. You don't do that unless you got the Holy Ghost. So we see that in our life, if we don't know the promises of God, our faith will stop where our knowledge stops. Which brings me to another story. You guys want to hear another story about a party?
Yeah.
Okay, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, FDR, right? You remember him, President of the United States? He was going through a series of time where he had to have all these meetings, all these parties, all these balls. And so one time he was having a gala event, presidential gala, at the White House, and he decided, you know what, I'm so tired of just putting on the smile and putting on the mask and just, you know, hi, how you doing, thanks for coming, that sort of a thing. So he decided as people were coming in, as he shook their hands on the way in, he was going to tell them, I murdered my grandmother this morning. So he puts on the big presidential smile, he's greeting people at the door, and as they're walking in, I murdered my grandmother this morning. I murdered my grandmother this morning. Hi, I murdered my grandmother this morning. And as they're walking in, they heard him, but it's just bouncing right off of them. They're saying, wonderful. Thank you, Mr. President. I murdered my grandmother this morning. Oh, keep up the good work, President. I murdered my grandmother this morning. You're doing a great job. And they're going in. Until finally, one foreign diplomat, as he came in, he greets him and he says, I murdered my grandmother this morning. And the guy got real serious and he leaned in and he said, Mr. President, I'm sure she had it coming. Which brings us to the final thing for today is that we can hear a lot of things, but we must accept what we hear as truth. See, we can hear the word of God. We can know what the scripture says up here. You can know that God wants to bless you, but not be blessed. You can know God wants to heal you and yet still not be healed. Why? Because there's something going on. There's a battle going on. And everything we hear, we can either accept it or we can reject it. Now, we may know it, but we've rejected it in our heart. And then when we say, well, where's God? Why hasn't God done it? I see it in the word of God and I believe it, but it's only a mental assent. It's only head knowledge about the word of God. I can see that God wants me healed in the Bible. I can prove that, but yet I'm not healed. And maybe it could be that we have not yet accepted the word of God as truth in our lives. In the book of Mark, the 4th chapter, if you want to turn there in your Bibles, Jesus is speaking a parable called the parable of the sower. Very important parable. In fact, Jesus says if you can understand that parable, you can understand all the parables. And so in the parable of the sower, we find out that there is a sower going out and he's sowing the word. Casting out, speaking, there's a preacher that's preaching the word of God. And the word is going into different kinds of soils. Now the different kinds of soils represent the different kinds of the heart. Now all of us have a heart that receives the word of God. We hear the word of God for our life. But it's very important how we hear what we hear. And so Jesus starts to talk about the soil that was by the wayside, right? It's too stony, it's too hard. And when the seed of the word of God is preached and spoken, it may hear it, but immediately the devil's able to come and steal it off the path. Why? Because it rejected it right away. Didn't even take any sort of root inside. So the devil comes and he steals away that word which was heard. Secondly, there's another type of soil that takes root, immediately springs up, but because it has no root within itself, when the sun rises, the heat hits it, and that plant withers and dies because it wasn't firm, it wasn't established. And that speaks of persecution, that when persecution arises for the word's sake, just like the rising of the sun, every day there's going to be pressure and trials that are placed on the word of God, your faith, that are going to try and burn it away. So we've got to have a deep-rooted faith where we believe God deep in our heart, not just say, oh yeah, I got it, I like it, I want it. You know, God, oh, you're so good, and thank you, God, and all that kind of stuff. But then when the persecution arises, oh no, I don't really, I'm not, that's not me. I said I knew that and I liked it, but you know what, it's just not, see, and it withers and dies. There's another type of ground that's sown, and it actually takes root and starts to grow. But the problem is that there's these thorns and thistles that come and they choke the word. And that speaks to the kind of heart that receives the word, and yet the cares of this life and the desires for other things and the deceitfulness of wealth comes and it chokes out the word so that it doesn't produce any fruit. But then there's one last kind of soil. That soil is the good soil that actually receives the word of God. And this is where it makes all the difference. Mark, the 4th chapter, verse number 20 says this. Talks about the good ground. But these are the ones sown on good ground. Those who hear the word. Everybody say, hear the word. But I want you to notice it doesn't stop at just hearing the word, because if that was all you had to do, all we would have to do is just take a recording of the gospel and play it everywhere all over the world, and everybody would get faith. But not only hear the word, but look at this, accept it and bear fruit. Some 30, some 60, some 100. See, the problem is that many people hear the word of God, but then before it can go into the heart, they either reject it, the pressures come, the cares of life come, and they now reject it out of their lives. That's why you find a lot of people that call themselves Christians, sitting in church service, know the word of God, yet have no faith in their lives and aren't overcoming, aren't victorious, aren't blessed, aren't prosperous, aren't healed, aren't whole, aren't delivered. Why? Because they got it up here, but they didn't receive it. They didn't have faith rise in their heart for it. See, our faith is not just a faith that just, you know, I heard it and therefore it comes out. No, our faith is based on some things. There is a something behind what we're believing. Someone, I should say, that's behind what we're believing. It's Almighty God Himself. Our faith is based on the validity of the one that promised. In other words, if this was just the word of man, I could only put so much stock in it and say, yeah, I believe that up to a point. But, you know, men fail. Men are flawed. Men aren't going to make it. But then when God comes, and this is Almighty God, this is the God who created the heavens and the earth. This is the one who carried out the plan of redemption. This is the one who all the prophecies concerning his son came true. This is the one who reached down and saved my soul. When God has a promise for my life, I don't look at just the promise alone. I look at the one who promised. I say, he's able to perform it. He's going to deliver it. He's faithful. He's just and he's true. D.L. Moody said this. He said, the best definition I can find of faith is the dependence upon the veracity of another. The Bible definition in the 11th chapter of Hebrews is faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. In other words, faith says amen to everything God says. Faith takes God without any ifs. If God says it, faith says, I believe it. Faith says amen to it. Maybe you heard the old saying, God said it, I believe it. That settles it. See, that's the kind of life we have to live. Let me show this whole principle to you, all of what we've talked about in one verse. Is that okay? One little verse, 1 Thessalonians, the second chapter, verse number 13. 1 Thessalonians, the second chapter, verse number 13 says this, for this reason, we also thank God without ceasing, because when you received the word of God, which you heard from us, you welcomed it, not as the word of men, but as it is in truth, the word of God, which also effectively works in you who believe. See, if you don't believe, the word of God is not going to take effect in your life. But the moment you start to believe God, the moment you start to accept and receive it as truth, God, you said it, I believe it, Lord, I have faith like a child, God, I'm taking you at your word, God. Now all of a sudden that word comes alive on the inside of you and it starts to produce fruit. I remember in my own life, there was a time my wife and I were newly married. We just moved out to go to Bible college. We were living in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Now, Tulsa is different than California in many ways. But growing up in California, I had, you know, those seasonal allergies. It used to be that every time the Santa Ana winds hit, I would just get a sinus infection. I knew it was coming. I knew the moment the news report said Santa Ana winds coming down, doggone it, I'm going to get a sinus infection. You know, and so every year after year, it was just without fail, I would get a sinus infection. Now, I go out to Tulsa. Tulsa does not have the Santa Ana winds. They have something different than we have, though. It's a plant called ragweed. It just sounds gross even talking about it. Ragweed. Ugh. Nasty stuff, right? And when this ragweed would grow up in the fall season, the pollen in the air was terrible, and my goodness, I got a sinus infection like you would not believe. It was so bad, it felt like someone took a knife, and not a butter knife, one of those Crocodile Dundee, that's a knife, right? And just plunged it in between my eyes and just left it hanging there out of my head. I mean, it was just, I was walking around like this. I was a cashier, so I'm at the cash register. Did you find everything you need today? You know? People are looking at me like, what's wrong with him? Californians are weird. And so I could not get healed. I mean, I tried everything, tried medications. I had a friend who had graduated from our same Bible college. I asked him, will you pray for me? He laid hands on me right there in the store that we worked at and just praying, man, spitting and sweating. And I mean, just making a spectacle right there in the front of the store, praying and everything. Like, he's all red in the face and hallelujah. You know, I was just, whoa, you know. Nothing worked though. Nothing. I was still terribly in pain. And so here I am, and mind you, I was raised in church, okay? I'm a little Baptist boy. Eventually, I got saved in the Evangelical Free Church. I had a friend whose dad was a pastor in Presbyterian Church, interned at a PCA church. And I mean, when I pray for all the churches, it's because I used to attend all of them. Really, that's why I pray for all the churches. And for the most part, my upbringing was in conservative churches, but my parents were wise enough about the Word of God to tell us, listen, don't just accept what a man says. You check that against the Word of God and see whether or not it's really true. And so when I would hear things like the last gifts died with the apostles, or the gifts are not for today, and that healing stuff, that doesn't work today, you know, you just kind of have to plod along or go to the doctor. You know, I rejected that. But in my experience on the other side of that, of really experiencing what the Word of God had to say, I had not crossed over into that yet. I knew it up here. I knew that God, you know, the gifts were today, and I knew that God wanted to heal. I believed that He could do it. But then in my experience, I never walked in faith for what God had for me. So here I am in pain. Here I am going to a Pentecostal Bible college, okay, that's preaching faith. In fact, one of my classes, the very first classes we attended while we were there, is called Christ the Healer. Reading a book called Christ the Healer. And I'm just frustrated going, God, if this is all true, then why am I not healed? Why haven't I yet received the promise, God? And I got fed up. One night, middle of the night, probably 2 a.m., I'm just up. Pain, here's the knife in my head, and I'm going, this stinks. So I got up and I was kind of like, okay, God, either I believe this or I don't. Either I'm getting healed right here, right now, or this is not true at all and I'm just done. So I decided I'm going to act out in faith. I'm believing the Word of God. God says, by His stripes I was healed. Therefore, God, I believe it. I receive it. And God, if that's true, I'm going to take a step of faith right now. I'm going to do something that I don't want to do as an act of obedience and faith. So I said, what's the most repulsive thing that I could do to my body right now to prove that I'm healed? I said, work out. So I said, all right, let's go. Start doing some sit-ups, start doing some push-ups, right? And so every rep, I'm there going, by His stripes I was healed. He sent forth His word and He healed me. Healing is the children's bread and I'm a child of God. See, I didn't know all the scriptures that I know now, so I kind of had to go through the same ones over and over again every rep. But listen, the point is, as I did it, man, I was just attacking it. I was going after it in faith. I was believing the Word of God, speaking it out of my mouth, hearing and finally accepting and receiving it as a promise for my life. So finally I felt released, and I got up, and I went back to bed, and I lay down and went to sleep. Had a good night's sleep finally after a long time. Next morning I woke up, pain was still there, but it wasn't as bad as the day before. Next day woke up, pain was a little less, you know, and day after day, confessing the promises of God, believing God, reading the scriptures about my healing, and after a while, let me tell you something, I have not had seasonal allergies. My second year in Bible college, when that ragweed sprang up, I did not get a sinus infection that year, and I'm believing God, I am healed in Jesus' name. No different in your life. You're going to believe God, you must hear the Word of God. Why? Because faith comes when the will of God is known. You've got to hear the Word of God. Your faith will stop where your knowledge stops. If you don't know what God has to say about your life, you cannot believe God and you won't receive anything from Him. And finally, you must accept what you hear as truth. Come on, can we give the Lord a great big praise today? Hallelujah. That's how faith comes. Hey, I want to talk to you guys before you leave. You guys have been great today. Thank you so much for your attention and your interest in the Word of God. You guys were wonderful. It'd be a tragedy if we stopped right now and let you go. And if your heart wasn't right with God and you died, that you went to hell and didn't go to heaven. I don't want that. You don't want that. But listen, most importantly, God doesn't want that. That's why Jesus died and went to the cross, beaten bloody mess. Public spectacle for all to see. So that we didn't have to go to hell. Now, sometimes people say, well, Pastor, I don't believe in hell. It's not real. Yes, it is. You know, the Bible talks about hell. Old and New Testament, Jesus Himself spoke about hell. It's a very real place. And just by burying your head in the sand, saying it's not real, doesn't make it go away. You're going to have to deal with the reality of it. Well, let's make sure you don't go there. Sometimes people say, well, Pastor, I'm not going to go there because, you know, all roads lead to heaven. You just do your thing. I'll do my thing. As long as we stay true to ourselves, churches out there, they can do their thing. God, gotta let us in. All roads lead to heaven. Can you show that to me in the Bible where it says all roads lead to heaven? Because it's not there. It's like saying all roads lead to the moon. You can drive around the earth as long as you want. You will never make it. The same way, you think God says after he goes to the cross and does all that, that he says, yeah, whatever you want to do, whatever they want to do, it doesn't matter. Just come on in. No. God tells us exactly how to get to heaven in his word. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man goes to the Father except by me. It means it's God's heaven. Got to get there God's way. Can't get there your way or my way or some well-meaning church committee's way. Going to have to get there God's way. Now, sometimes people say, well, Pastor, that's good news because I know God's way is by being good. And I've been really good. You know, I used to be bad, but cleaned up my act. Now I'm good. Done a lot of good deeds in my lifetime, given money to charities, gotten involved in social justice causes. I'm nice to my neighbors and my relatives. Therefore, I think God's going to let me into heaven because I've been a really good person. But the problem is, could you show me in the Bible how good you have to get into heaven? There's no grading scale, no line, no curve, none of that stuff that you have to meet up to. Be this good and you get to go to heaven, or have your good outweigh your bad and then you get to go to heaven. Clean up your act. I don't see that anywhere in the Bible. Nowhere in the Bible say that your goodness will get you in heaven, because if you're trying to get to heaven by your goodness, the standard is perfection. The only one who is perfect, his name is Jesus. And the Bible tells us that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Not going to make it based on your goodness, because your goodness compared to God's goodness, the Bible says, is like filthy rags. Going to be thrown out, not going to get to stay. So come on, let's talk about your eternal life. What makes you think you're going to heaven? Sometimes people say, well, Pastor, I'm going to go to heaven because I was raised in church. Parents told me you were Christians growing up. Hung a cross or St. Christopher around your neck. Had you baptized or christened as a child. Went to religious classes like Sunday school, catechism class, maybe Sabbath school class. And born in America. America's a Christian nation. Everybody born in America is going to heaven. We're not any other religions. We're not Buddhist, Muslim, Hindus. Therefore, we're Christians headed for heaven, right? Wrong. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible? Check it out. Nowhere does it say you're raised in church, parents tell you you're Christian. That makes you a Christian. Nowhere in the Bible does it say you attend religious classes, wear religious jewelry, be baptized a Christian as a child, or be born in America, and that gets you into heaven. And I don't see anywhere in the Bible that God's looking at your life and says, well, you're not some other religion. I guess I'll put you in the category of being a Christian. You get to go to heaven. Deny your presence in hell. Come on, let's talk about your eternal life. Somebody in this room said, well, Pastor, I get that, but not only when I was a child did I go to church. Here I am sitting in church in front of you right now. I consider myself to be a Christian. Doesn't that mean I'm a Christian because I'm here in church? Well, no. That's like me putting on a Dodgers uniform, driving down to Los Angeles, sitting in the Dodger dugout, calling myself a Dodger. Listen, I could bring my bat and my ball and expect to get to play in the game. You know what's going to happen? They're going to find me sitting there, drag me out, and lock me up. Why? Because I'm not a Dodger. Same way, you can't just sit in church service, call yourself a Christian. That makes you a Christian. You say, I get that, Pastor, but you don't understand. You're talking about volunteers. My last church, I volunteered for a number of years. Helped out, sang in the choir, carried the pastor's Bible, made decisions in that church. People thought of me as a leader. I taught in the Bible classes. Come on. I even got a membership card to that church. And while that's great, and I'm glad you did those things, could you just show that to me in the Bible? Where your church involvement or your volunteerism gets you into heaven. See, now we're back to good works. It's not going to make it. So he said, okay, Pastor, I understand all that, but you don't understand. Someone told me that if I knew God, I'm a Christian. I know God. Know about Easter and the resurrection, celebrate Christmas, sing the songs every year of my life. I can quote scriptures to you, Pastor. Doesn't that mean that I'm a Christian? Well, the problem with that thinking is if you'd read your Bible, you know that demons believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. They're not Christians. You know, the Bible records the devil himself knows who Jesus is and believes that he's the Son of God and can quote scriptures out of his mouth. And yet that doesn't qualify him for heaven. Remember, we were talking about just hearing and believing with your head. God's not after your mental assent. Look up here. Look up here. Not after what's in your head. God's not after your mental assent, knowing who he is and believing with your head that he's God. He's after a real heart faith. That's what this is really all about. Jesus said it like this. He said, you must be born again. Now, I know there's controversy over that word. Society, movies, Hollywood, television, books, and the internet have made it out to be some weirdo, goofy, crazy thing that no one wants to be a part of. Listen, I don't even want to be a part of what they're making it out to be. I want to be a part of what the Bible says. What does being born again really mean? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means that you've given God all of your heart and that you've given God all of your life. Just that simple. Being born again means you've given God all of your heart, given God all of your life. It's that simple. You must be born again if you want to go to heaven. and deny your presence in hell. No other way. Let me prove it to you that God's looking for all of your heart and all of your life. Let me prove it to you in the last book of the Bible, book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking to a church just like he's speaking to us here in this church today. And he says, I'm coming. Don't you know he's coming soon? And he says, and when I come, I want to find you hot, or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Now, those are gross, graphic words from the mouth of Jesus, but really, what's he saying? What's he talking about? Lukewarm, what's that? Well, it's a little in, little out, little up, little down, a little token prayer every now and then, an occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. And you're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. So today, your call, your choice. In a moment, I'm going to give you an opportunity. Jesus said, you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father who is in heaven. But if you deny me, I will deny you. Today, here's your opportunity. In a moment, I'm going to count to three, just like this. One, two, three, and then I'm going to pop my hands together. Bang! When you hear the sound of my hands popping together, just like that, bang! That's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, head of heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can put it right back down. Now, you might be thinking, whoa, 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 whoa. Wait a second. Time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be. Let's get over that today, because think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than just end up in hell forever and ever and ever and ever? No one would make that trade. Moment of possible embarrassment for an eternity away from God. Come on. Yet the devil's trying to steal that word out of your heart. Cares, persecution for the word's sake are arising right now, trying to choke it out, burn it out of your life. Come on. This is your time to press in. Will you believe the word that you've heard, that if you give God all your heart and all of your life, that you will be saved? That's what this is all about. Calling on the name of the Lord today. We want to do that with you. So, hey, who should raise their hand in a moment? You've been running from God instead to God? Speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Today is your day. Come on, make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this? Never said yes to Jesus, giving him all of your heart and all of your life? Come on, I'm speaking to you. Finally, who should raise their hand in this place? If you're lukewarm and you know that's the condition of your heart when I described it, you can get right with God in this safe and friendly church service. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching my television in the foyer or in the Love Rock Cafe, come on, put the burger down, get ready to get your hand up. Online, across the nation, around the world, God sees right where you're at, and then you can press the button that says on our homepage, How to Know God, or if you see the blue button next to your browser, you can click that button that says Respond to God, and someone will lead you in a prayer. I'm going to count to three. Pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go. If you need to do this, get ready to get your hand up. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now. If that's you, that's you. Just raise them up high. Thank you. There's one. There's two. There's three. Four. Thank you. God bless you. Where else? Where else are you at? Give me a little wave if I don't see you yet. There's four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten. Thank you. Who else? 11 up top. Gotcha. Thank you. Anyone else? Anyone else real quick? 11. Okay. Over there. Gotcha. 12. Thank you. God bless you. Who else today? Come on. I didn't embarrass them. And I won't embarrass you. Just raise it up high for me if that's you. I didn't see you yet, but you're saying, yeah, I know I need to give God all my heart. No, I need to give God all my life. Anybody back here? Anybody in that family room? Anybody else? Come on, just raise it up high for me right now if that's you. Thank you. Got you up there, 13. God bless you. Who else today? Anybody else? Anybody in the center sections? Come on, just raise it up high for me if that's you. Anybody else? About 13 wise people. Come on, number 14. You're sitting there wondering if you should do this. Yeah, you should. Go for it. Come on. Raise it up high. If you feel the tug of God at your heart, that's the Holy Spirit just saying, come on, you need to do this. Feel like your heart's going to beat out of your chest right now. Hey, God's speaking to you. Anybody else real quick? About 13 wise people. Will you join them? Anybody else? Thank you. God bless you right there. Who else today? 14? Come on, number 15. You were waiting for that number 15. If that's you, come on, just pop it up high for me. Number 15, come on. Raise it up high. Where you at? Come on, you know you need to do it. Let's go. Let's go. Anybody else? All right, well, let's give the Lord a great big praise for about 14 wise people. Hallelujah. All right, here's what we're going to do. All 14 of you, or number 15, you rascal. You should have raised your hand, but you didn't. It's not too late. Here's what I want you to do. In a moment, we're all going to stand, give a clap and a shout. As we do, that's your cue. Get your stuff, whatever you brought with you to church. Coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Once you get in the aisle and meet me up front, because we're going to change destinies today, but we can't do that till we get you down here, right? I'm going to call on the name of the Lord, and you will be saved. So let's all stand and welcome them. You raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand. You come right now. Make your way to the front. Get your stuff. Get a friend if you need a friend. Get in the aisle and meet me right now. Come on down.
Jesus, I believe.
They're coming. Let's give them a hand as they come. You can come too.
Jesus, I belong to you.
Hallelujah.
You're the reason that I live. You're the reason that I
They're still
breathe.
Coming.
Jesus,
come on, you can come
I
too.
Believe.
This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. The family rooms.
Jesus,
bring your children.
I
they'll remember this. Come on down.
To you. You're the reason that
From
I
the foyer,
live.
If you raise your hand, you can come in.
You're the reason that
come on down.
I breathe. Jesus, I
They're still coming. They're still coming. Come on, you can come too right now. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation.
Jesus, I
Hallelujah.
Breathe.
All right. Hey, everybody up front, do this for me. Put a big smile on your face. This is not a bad thing. This is a good thing. Came to give God all your heart, came to give God all of your life. That's the best decision of your life right there. Pretty cool. Right over here to my right, your left, this is Pastor Joel. Waving at you. Really good guy. Nothing weird goes on. You know, sometimes you go to church, you wonder, are they weird? I'm about as weird as you're going to get today, okay? He's cool, all right? So it's all downhill from here. This is the weird peak, pinnacle. He's neat, all right? He's going to do three things with you. I'm going to let you know what they are in advance. He's going to lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus into your heart. You're going to call on the name of the Lord, and you will be saved. Secondly, he's going to give you some free information, some free literature, help find out what to do next. Now that you're a Christian, what do I do next, okay? It's easy reading. It's free. He'll give it to you. And then thirdly, he's going to introduce you to a program that we have here called Spiritual Personal Trainers. Can I describe it to you like this? It's a friend in church who will help you to get strong in the ways of the Lord. We all need a friend. Come alongside us and encourage us, okay? Help you build faith in your life. For now that you've given your heart and life to Jesus, what do you do next? That spiritual personal trainer is a friend. Come alongside you for 5 weeks, teach you five things out of the Bible, one a week. Real easy, free, and you need to do it, okay? He'll describe how it works, and then he'll let you come right back out. Your friends and family will wait for you. Now listen. Make a promise to you guys. Give us 1 year of your life here at the Rock Church World Outreach Center consistently. Sitting under the teaching here at the Rock Church. You can get to Sunday morning at 10 a.m. Come on, consistently, every week that you can. Can't make it Sunday, maybe you can make it Saturday at 10. Maybe you can make it Sunday night at 6, Wednesday night, 7 o'clock. Young adults on Friday night or women's Bible study, 9:30 on Thursdays. As much as you can, okay? Get consistent in the things of God. And after that year and for the rest of your life, here's the promise. You will look around and you will say, my goodness, I did not know I could be this blessed. Am I telling the truth, everybody? Take their word for it. You guys can make a left turn. Follow Pastor Joel right this way. Come on, let's give them a hand as they go. Hallelujah.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.